Good morning. How are you? Great to be here. President Healy, thank you so much for this kind invitation. And thank you for Bangkok, Thailand, to host us during this event. Last time I was here was 30 years ago. Can you believe it? 30 years ago. And actually, it was 1986. That was the year I graduated from Babson College. And my parents invited me for a graduation present to come to Thailand. As a matter of fact, we stay in this same hotel. Can you believe it? 30 years ago. The beds are improved, for sure. So I'm delighted to be here to share a little bit of a story of our company that I represent. Its name is Florida Ice and Farm Company. We're not in Florida State. We don't have an ice and a farm business anymore, but we kept the name for over 100 years old, the company is. And I do want to say something to all of you. What I'm going to share with you, it has been the hard work of all the executives and leaders that work for me, and I just happen to be honored to present what is Triple Bottom Line. It's been a journey for us ever since we embraced this philosophy. This picture that you see here, it could be Thailand or it could be Costa Rica, where I'm originally from. So I traveled 25 hours a couple of days ago to be here. It's over 17,000 kilometers of distance between Costa Rica and Thailand. But you know what? It's amazing the coincidence that we have, because we're pretty much in the same latitude. So the warmth of the weather, the climate, you know, the fruits, the rivers, you know, the nature, there are so much similarities between our two countries. Costa Rica is a small country in Central America. But if I can summarize Costa Rica for you, we had some visionary presidents that make very specific decisions in the modern history of our country. In 1948, one of our presidents abolished the army completely and dedicated all those resources to fund free education for all the children in our country. And that had made a big impact ever since for the literacy rate of our country. A few years later, another president protected 25% of its territory for national parks, protecting the diversity of our country. And in 1986, we had a president that was the Peace Nobel recipient because he brought peace to the Central American region. Not that we needed in Costa Rica per se, but our neighboring countries. We were in the middle of a conflict between the West and East. And there is a famous philanthropy, Schmidt Hein, a Swiss guy, who said there cannot be successful companies in failed societies. And I cannot agree more with that principle, that if we want to prosper in our business, we need to have sound societies progressing. So let me introduce FIFCO, short name for our company, to all of you. So we are a public traded company, and we've been in business for over 100 years, doing what we love to do best, brewing beer. That's where we originated our business. We have over 6,500 employees, about revenues of 1.3 billion, and we have business, our geographic footprint is in all throughout Central American countries and the United States. And we're pretty much based on three businesses: beverages, liquid beverage, if you will, is a core business for us. So we go from dairy products to beer to wine to spirits to juices, carbonated soft drinks. And but we also have a hospitality business and a retail operation. We have three strategic partners in the beverage space. Heineken, the beer producer, owns 25% of our company, but we also have a strong relationship with Diageo and the spirits, also with PepsiCo on the soft drink business, and we partner with Marriott in our hospitality business. So let me start today with a provocative question or comment to you. I sincerely believe that we need to evolve in the way we do business nowadays. When we went back to school, you know, maybe 30, 40 years ago, you know, we were taught the concept that we needed to maximize shareholder value, right? That's what we were taught. And that's what I at least did over time maximizing shareholder value, right? And we need all to do that. But I believe we need to evolve in the way we've been conducting business. We need to create a more holistic approach. And we need to maximize the value that we create and share that wealth with all the stakeholders and not just the shareholder. And by stakeholders, I mean our employees, our consumers, customers, suppliers, and so on. But why? Why do we need to evolve in the way we conduct businesses? Because I would argue with you that we live in a society that is not quite failed yet, but we have so many environmental and social challenges today, all the way from inequality, poverty rates in our countries, climate change issues, malnutrition, you name it. We have too many social and environmental issues. And we, from the private sector, I would argue with you that we have a critical role here to play. Much more than just generating employment and paying our taxes, which is normally the question I get from many business people when I encounter with them. I believe every business, no matter in which business you are, in what category, whether it's in agriculture, whether it's consumer goods products, in technology, we all create footprints, social and environmental footprints. But it's up to us to recognize that by doing business, we do generate footprints, social and environmental footprints. But it's our responsibility at least to recognize those footprints. And once we recognize those footprints, start doing something about it. So I want to introduce this new way of doing business. So you know, I'm pretty sure all of you read Adam Smith, right? The father of capitalism. He wrote a book in 1776 called The Wealth of Nations, right? That's where all started, the capitalism. But you know what, 17 years before, he wrote another book called The Theory of the Moral Sentiments. And in that book, he framed the principles of a better society. But as we progress in life, actually, society pay more attention to the wealth of nations, forgetting a little bit about the theory of the moral sentiments. But when you combine both of those principles together, I think magic starts happening. And we should be at least acknowledge this. So nowadays, in modern times, many visionary people and great scholars have written about it. Michael Porter called it share value. Chris Laslio called it embedded sustainability. And one of my preferred books is Conscious Capitalism, that was written by the CEO of Whole Foods, John Mackey, and a great professor from Babson, Rash Sisodia. And I got really inspired by this last book. So many principles, many books, many names, but basically the same principles behind. And I like to refer by triple bottom line. So what does it mean, triple bottom line? It's basically is with the same rigorosity that we take care of our financial performance in our businesses, we should be doing the same thing with our environmental and social dimensions and create value at the same time. There's no trade-offs between them, or should not be trade-offs between the three. And I want to share a little bit of an analogy with you between a caterpillar that transforms itself into a butterfly through the magic process of the metamorphosis. As you know, the butterfly, it seems to be that the only purpose it has in life is to eat and eat and eat as much as it can. And I would argue with you that the vast majority of companies out there, it seems to be that the main purpose in life is to make as much money as it can, extracting as much from the planet and even sometimes from their own people. On the other hand, we have the butterfly, which its main function is to share the food with all those around them. And we, as business people, we have a choice to make here. We can continue operating at a caterpillar level, or we can start evolving as a butterfly, sharing the wealth that we create among all stakeholders. And that's the thing I want to share with you today. So let me give you a little bit of the FIFCO's journey, our company, over the last decade. I joined this company 14 years ago. And as with any CEO that, you know, comes into a new job or a new position, you know, we have always the pressure to make our companies as efficient. And we have gone through 5 different milestones in the history of the last 12 years in our company. Obviously, when I joined the company, I have to make it very efficient. You know, productivities, bring the innovations, KPIs, the usual suspects, you know. But I also, 2 years later, led a very important growth era for our company. What it have taken the company 7 years to double the size of the company, I put a challenge to my management team, 50 people at that time, and I said, I want to double the size of our business. But instead of taking 7 years, last time we did that, I want this team to show us that we can double the size, but in 2 years. Why 2 years and not 3? Well, I knew the quality of the team that I had, that we can do it. And then we went through a very rapidly expansion area. We did 4 acquisitions in 18 months. We expanded into new geographies, new categories. We enter into the wine business, the spirits business. I enter into a dairy business. We acquire a very important, significant business operation in the United States, which really doubled the size of our company at that time. But there are 2 decisions that I feel most proud, because any CEO will have to go through efficiency, will have to go through growth and expansion, right? That's what it is expected from us. But I want to share the 2 most important decisions I think we made that I feel the most proud of it. And that was in 2008, when we decided to merge our business strategy with our corporate social responsibility, thus becoming a triple bottom line company. And later in 2016, when we discovered the purpose of our company, the reason for being. Why do we wake up every day and come to work? And I asked that question to our management team. And through that question, we found out what should be the purpose of FIFCO. So, and through all these 10 years, when I joined the company, there was a company that we were selling $150 million back in 2003. Today we're 1.3, and the profitability over this time has grown 6 times, profit-wise, while implementing the triple bottom line, which has been the turning point for our organization. So let me tell you a little bit of that strategy. When we merged the business strategy with the corporate social responsibility I was referring to you, and thus becoming triple bottom line, I would argue with you that most of you and your company, you have a lot of philanthropy or corporate social responsibility. That is very important. But the difference is when you merge the two, the business strategy and the corporate social responsibility, and you bring it to the top of the organization. Because if you do that, every single decision your company will make will be based on this triple bottom line. And you would always live with a tension between profits and doing the right thing for the environment and for the social dimension, your employees. And I want to share the way we went about in doing it. Because most of the time when I speak with business leaders in many forums like this, the number one question that I get asked is, okay, that all sounds very nice, but how do you do it? So we developed this homemade recipe, because there was no textbook I wish I could have one that will show me each of the steps that we needed to do. And this recipe that I want to share with you, the five steps I call it here, is a recipe that I want to share with everybody I encounter with. It is not the recipe of my beer brand that I will never ever share with nobody. But sharing this, I think, is the right thing to do. So number one thing to do when you engage in sustainability practices on a triple bottom line, the most important thing is to find out what your stakeholders are really expecting from you as a responsible company. It's not what the management think or your shareholders. Yeah, you have to take into account that input as well. But you can use the knowledge of market research that we all learn to try to anticipate consumer demands, customers' preferences, and so on. But you can use those same principles and do systematic research with all your stakeholders and ask them, what do you expect from us as a responsible company? And by the way, make sure you include your enemies. Let me put it that way. We're an alcohol company, so I have many people that hate our industry, okay? But through this process, I went and interviewed those NGOs, those people who oppose us, congressmen, women, those who regulate us. I wanted to know what they were really thinking from our company. And yes, we did the same thing with consumers, employees, customers, suppliers, NGOs, media, and so on. So number one, get access to what they think from you as a responsible company. Number two is make sure your leaders buy into the strategy. It's not here Ramon trying to, you know, your leaders needs to be convinced that we're doing this for the right reasons. Set 3BL goals, measure 3BL, that I'll come back later with that, and very importantly, the fifth step, always report back to society on your commitments. Because I have learned when you make public your commitments, and you go out and I said, I stand for this, I would do this and this by X year, there's no way you're gonna fall back from that position. Once you make public commitments, you drive the organization towards those goals. So those five simple steps that we've been following over since 2008. So in 2008, we listened to our stakeholders, and if I can summarize it for you, they told us four things. They told us many things, many good things the company was doing. Remember, we're a beverage company, right? And we have retail and hospitality. But what the number one social footprint they told us was a harmful use of alcohol. They said to us, you know, the most critics, all you want to do is to get drunk our children. And what the heck are you going to do about that? They were very vocal. Number two, they say solid waste. I see all your PET bottles, all your cans floating in our rivers and beaches, and we want you to clean all that mess. Number three, the water. We use water in all our products. So you say, the most critics, all you want to do is to take the water away from our communities and export your products. And you know there are people who don't have access to water. And number fourth, carbon emissions. I see all your trucks, I see all, you know, we have hundreds and thousands of trucks driving in every single market that we operate. So four footprints, three environmental, one social. But the harmful use of alcohol by far was the most sensitive to our society. So we went out with that feedback and we share all this information with our executives. They were used to before that, just to learn, you know, how much profits, how much market share we need to increase, you know, but this is the first time we're putting all this information society was giving in to us to their hands. And then we decided jointly, what are we going to do about that? So at that time in 2008, we did four commitments with society. We said, number one, we will improve the consumption patterns of our society in terms of alcohol drink. Every time a Costa Rican will drink beer, wine, or spirits, it will take five drinks on average and 1.72 5 times a week. But after you take 5 drinks on one sit, it leads to intoxication. So that consumption pattern is not good. So what we needed to do was first to learn that, second, to spread the consumption. So every time you sit down, you can take 2.5 drinks, but and actually you can do it 3-4 times a week. Many European countries like Spain, Portugal, they have this similar pattern. But if you go to countries like UK, Finland, Norway, boof, even worse than Costa Rica. So with that feedback, I led for 3.5 years a research I did from Mexico to Argentina, all Latin American countries, 18 countries. I pulled that data all together. I convinced my partners at Heineken, ABI, Ambev, Polar, you know, all the Latin American beer producers. And we instituted the whole methodology. And for the first time, we had the magic of the information. So I was able then to convince the World Health Organization that instead of they trying to decrease our per capita consumption, which is normally what they wanted to do with us as an industry, I said, allow us the time that we can improve the consumption pattern. And we are in that journey. Because the industries that don't take ownership of the footprint that we create, we then are most likely we're going to get higher taxation, more stringent laws, regulations. So it is for us as an industry to recognize our footprints. You talk about carbonated soft drinks, you see all the issues we have with obesity. So carbonated soft drinks, for instance, that's another footprint that we had that came later in the research 4 years. So we're working with the industry to really reduce the amount of sugar that it goes into our products. I'm giving you an example. But we also compromised to become a zero solid waste company by 2011. We will not send a garbage bag to a landfill no more. And we did that in 2011. We became the first company to become a water neutral company. What does it mean to be water neutral? You use all this water to produce your product, you know, and also the water that goes inside, and then you try to reduce it to the minimum level, and once you reduce it, you go out and compensate. How do you compensate? You go out and build aqueducts to communities that don't have access to potable water, or you protect rainforests. There's a whole hierarchy for this. So in 2012, FIFCO was one of the first companies to become water neutral by 2012. And we achieved that. And in 2008, when we put forward those objectives, to be quite honest, we didn't know exactly how we were going to do it. But we just made a commitment. And then everything, for 4 years, we make every single decision in order to reach that state of the art. And then we did the same thing for carbon neutral, which is coming this year. And why the years and the differences? Because society, for them, was more sensitive, being the waste, then the water, and then the carbon emissions. So that's why we went with these years. So let me share with you some of the external. I talk about the most important one with the smart consumption of alcohol. So we developed these principles, and now the industry, I'm very proud to say that most of the big players are using the same philosophy that we helped pioneer many years ago. Our most important one is that we will respect those who decided not to drink, which is about normally 60% of the population. And we want to foster moderation in the way we consume our products for the other 40%. And there is this very important group, we call it the sensitive population, underage drinking, drink and driving, pregnant women, that never, under no circumstances, they should drink alcohol products. And we train our employees as ambassadors of this philosophy. We train our customers and consumers and also society. But first we start inside out as responsible ambassadors of our product. I want to introduce this concept I call the strategic social investment as we project to our communities. So we know that our countries and communities, we all have this amount of different challenges, right? I was referring to. And we, in our business, we create these footprints as well. So for me, strategic social investment is about finding the sweet spot in where you can bring your knowledge, right? You can bring your competences. You can bring your volunteering through your employees and work in improving those problems that society has and also that you are creating at the same time. That's what I call strategic social investment. So I want to share with you, in 2008, when we started doing this, I was doing a lot of philanthropy. I was writing a lot of checks to very good causes. All my board members had a lot of commitments to the National Symphony Orchestra, I don't know. But none of them were geared to our footprints. So we started, and I said to my finance guy, how much money are we devoting to all these good causes? And it was less than 1% of your net profits. And I said, wow, that sounds like a really small amount that we are dedicating. So over years, we start changing that percentage to 3%. And then a study came in from done by BCC about 4 years ago. In that study, conducted with European and American companies, 54% of the companies interviewed for this research said that they invest less than 1% of their net profits for strategic social investments. 1% invested more than 6% of your net profits. Microsoft at the best, 8.5 at that time. So I wonder, how much money in your individual companies are we devoting to strategic social investment? So we started with less than 1%, we increased it to 3%, and I'm very proud to say last year we did 8% of our net profits are dedicated to strategic social investment on growing profits. So the amount of money we're giving back to society through different communities engagements or projects that we do, that I will share with you some of this. And believe me, the proud of the employees, seeing that the company is actually really putting a lot of its resources into these causes, you have no idea. It's the best thing that can start happening to our organization. So we start with a new way of connecting with our employees. Every employee in our company dedicates 2 working days to do volunteering time off. All right, and we benchmarked. The best company at that time was Intel for us in Costa Rica. And with them, we got inspired. We learned about their program, and then, you know, we actually, today, almost 90% of our employees participate in all the countries that we had operations. We have already devoted more than 400,000 hours of BTO time, and this is the one of the best examples how we can engage our employees to go out and work. One employee lost his house in an earthquake in Costa Rica, and we went out, 1,300 people, to build a house for this employee. That was the first BTO that we did. But you know what was the real reaction from the employees? It could happen to any of us. They said to me, Ramon, it could happen to any of us. So I'm very proud to go and help this employee, and then 14 different families that also lost the house. And that was the way we started with this BTO. One very interesting project we did as part of this strategic social investment, we partnered with Professor Muhammad Yunus. I know many of you know him because he was a keynote speaker at Babson last year. So he's the founder of Grameen Bank, microfinancing. So we went to visit him in Bangladesh, you know, not once, I have to go twice. Why? Because we were an alcohol producer company and he had second thoughts on us. But after we learned and we got to know each other 5 years, so we launched the first social business. You know, he wrote this amazing book on social business. But I said, Professor, I want to take your concept out of Bangladesh and I want to bring it to Central America, an open competition. So we launched, we have one company, a JV with Professor Muhammad Yunus, that is called NutriVida, and our mission is to eradicate undernutrition. So we develop soups, powdered beverages, and instant cereal with a bucket of micro ingredients, nutrient ingredients, that really are helping eradicate the malnutrition. So we're exporting this concept, and we're very pleased with the progress on this particular initiative. Let me tell you a little bit about our internal social goals, which is our employees, one of the most important things. So I was telling you that in 2012, we expanded to new categories and new geographies too fast, too soon. And as a result of that, we lost connection with our employees. I can feel it when I was going through this. You know, we were 3,800 employees, and boom, over 18 period, I was 6,500, and you know, we lost a little bit of a connection. So we embarked on this purpose quest that I was referring to you. The purpose, you know, I would ask you, you know, what are the two most important days of our lives? First question to the first day is the easiest one. It's the day that we were born, right? When life comes. But the second one is the toughest one. It's the day that we realize why we were born. Why are we here? Most people in their lives goes without not even answering that question. So my provocation to you is to think about it. Those of you who already know what your purpose in life, you're far ahead of the crowd, of many of us. So I ran into this little company, boutique out of UK, and I was going from a personal perspective finding that answer. And he said to me, you know, Ramon, what you're missing in your company as you have expanded so much, your higher purpose. I said, wow, yes, but I don't know how to go about it. He said, don't worry, I'll show you the way. So we went into a mountain retreat for 3 days. You can imagine the president of my board, what the heck, Ramon, are you gonna do now in the mountain in Costa Rica, secluded, you know, no iPhones, no computers. We learned to listen to the damn butterflies, you know, the insects, the river. We listened to our hearts. And when we came out of that, I went there with 14 of my executives, and we discovered the purpose of our organization that was perhaps hidden in the history of our company. And that purpose is very simple but very powerful. It's we bring a better way of living to the world. Compartimos con el mundo una mejor forma de vivir. That's in Spanish. We bring a better way of living to the world. You can't imagine what this statement meant to us. So when I went out with this, with my 50 executives, then I did for a 500, 2,000, 3,000. I went every single sharing that. But it was not about sharing the purpose. It was open our hearts to our organization. And goddamn, I wish I had done that many years back. Because this has been perhaps the most important thing. And I tell you one thing, my learning. If we earn the hearts of our employees, we will have their minds forever. You could have the most amazing trademarks, brands, technology, distribution systems, but as we all know, earn the hearts of your employees, you will have the most successful company. I guarantee you that. We needed to learn how to lead the new, our new people, our new organization. And I want to bring this concept to you on the new human capital trends that are happening in every single organization today. And I, you know, we have the convergence of generations, the aging of the population, the active participation of women. But one that really, really, really strikes me is the convergence of the generations. 52% of my entire population, workforce, are millennials. You know, 52%. Only 9% are baby boomers like me. But millennials, they're very loyal to their leaders, but not to the organization, like we baby boomers, we used to do, or be. So you want to convince these employees of working in your company, you better start acting very differently. And we have learned that we have to basically, over time, get rid of all the hierarchy, the structures that we used to have. And we've been in this collaboration way of leading our people now, exploring and co-creating. And when I have a very difficult task or an amazing opportunity, I don't ask my hierarchy teams to solve it. Now I set up teams of 10 people with different backgrounds, gender, background, to go out and explore. Slow down a bit the process initially, but the end product that you get by conforming your teams in a whole different way, it's amazing, the output that you get and the transformation that you go through. And this is the way we need to be leading our people. Forget hierarchies. I hate it. You can imagine when we start, I have 42 teams now on this. And you can imagine we have like an internal revolution inside our company now, because the hierarchy, you still need them for some things. But we have 42 teams working across different issues. But the quality of the product, of the end games, of the solutions is really transforming our organization. And I cannot be more proud of it. Initially with a lot of skepticism. But as we go through, this is the new way I sincerely believe we need to be leading our people. So let me share one of the programs that I feel most proud. I mentioned to you when I was sharing the purpose with our organization, I was with 3,500 employees in a big salon, in a big meeting room. And one of them grabbed the microphone and said, "Ramon, you know, I'm very proud of all the things that this company has been doing for so many times. You know, I see you getting all these speeches and interviews on TV, newspaper, all that, you know, good things for the climate, many things you're doing for the employees. But I wanted to ask you, you know, we have people living under poverty conditions in this company. I want to know, what are you planning to do about that?" And this was an employee from one of our manufacturing facilities. And all of a sudden, 3,500 people start, you know, applauding, you know. I said, like, so I grabbed the microphone and I said, "Well, you're absolutely right. And I'm so sorry to hear this. And to be honest, I didn't know we had that situation inside our own company. Truth of the matter. But I said, allow me 6 months and we will come back with a solution for this issue." So I became an expert on this. So just to share a couple of things. 22% of the people living in Costa Rica live under poverty conditions. And we're not proud of that. If you go to the northern part of Central America, 72%. Many societies, we face this issue. But I didn't know so how many of those people inside our company were living on that. So I hire some external workers, social workers, help us. 3.6% of our employees were living under poverty conditions. So we develop a 360 comprehensive program that takes care of health, nutrition, housing, family finance, the most important one. They get in debt with, you know, they want a high a TV and all the good stuff. You know, they spend more than what they earn. That was primarily the basic problem. Many of them have more than one family, which we have to go through all those learnings and experiences. But what it takes the government 10 years to bring a citizen out of poverty conditions, according to the United Nations, for me, 10 years were way, way too much. And I committed to my employees that we will lift up every single soul out of poverty conditions in 3 years. Because I could not wait for that long. So imagine If we start doing that, one company at a time, and we start with our own employees, and we do not let this issue for the government to be solved, I think we can create consciousness about this issue and help build a better society. So we're 1.5 years into the program, and you have no idea the results we're coming back with this. But what I've never, ever envisioned, I cannot tell you enough about those families and their thankful, their gratitude, not only the employee, but their families, because we've helped them with psychologists. You know, there are many things, the macho man in Latin America, we are teaching them how to become better. You know, one woman said, well, you know, Ramon, before I had my husband come in here, bring me the food, turn the TV. Now, no more of that. He talks to the family. He's a good husband and a good father. Thank you for teaching him and us how to be better people at the end of the day. But what I've never realized, what the effect that happened of this program with the 97% of our entire population. When they saw the company really taking care of this situation. Perhaps you can argue with me that this is not expected, it's not part of our responsibilities. But beyond that, if you want incredible employees, motivated and engaged, think about it. Our leadership index, as we measure with Great Place to Work, you know, skyrocketed 14 points. Normally, I don't know if many of you may work with Great Place. I found a very good methodology. If you do the right things, you normally improve your score in the leadership index, like the way we measure this one, 3 points a year. So we score 14 points in 1 year. So the guys who runs for Latin America, he couldn't believe the results. So he requests that we repeated the survey among our employees. So they came back the same results. And he said, I've never, ever seen in my entire career such an important increase. And I said, I laugh. And I said, it's all related to the purpose. That's exactly the year before when we implemented this. So our environmental goals, well, basically what we want to do here with our environmental goals is to minimize those footprints. I put an elephant here. Sorry, I know elephant is very precious in Thailand, but elephant has a big footprint, right? So we want to do this like a mice, a little footprint, environmental footprint, in terms of water, solid waste, and carbon emissions, just to make the point here. So how we do it, we measure first, and most important, we reduce. Many companies work on the reduction. You know, I can tell you about Heineken, the PepsiCo, the partners that I work with in beverages especially. But none work on the compensation. So I think we still have a long way to go. So measuring our business success in 3BL, this is perhaps one of the most important things that I want to share with you. Back in 2011, the World Economic Forum chose FIFCO as one of the top sustainability companies in the world. And one of the reasons I know they chose us was because of this. The way we remunerate our executives and employees. So before 2008, as you know, variable compensation is very important in the private world, right? So 60% of my total compensation is variable. All my direct reports is 50%, right? So we changed that way we were remunerated from 100% economic KPIs, all right? Usual suspects, market share, EBITDA, you know, EVA, you know, whatever your measurements are. We reduce it from 100% to 60%. And then we introduce 30% related to social goals and 10% to environmental goals. The beauty of this, everything can be measured. Because when you don't measure, you don't change it. Even from water, you know, the amount of water that we use, for instance, is a KPA, our Great Place to Work engagement, our volunteering hours, you know, the beauty of it, and we use balance, you know, we have a very robust balance scorecard. We have SAP systems, so we every executive have on a daily basis how they're doing against this. So there's no surprises at the end of the year. But I tell you one thing. I know in sustainability practice, I've been with many, many people talking and discussing this. Most of them like to write on the wall good intentions, and yes, we will do this. But there is a fundamental difference. When you touch the wallet of your executives and leaders, you will see them. You will see them really moving into that. Changing the compensation structure was perhaps one of the most difficult decisions we had with our board of directors back in 2008, just in the middle of the financial crisis. And one banker, we had a banker in our board of directors, said, Ramon, you know, I've been supporting you, you know, for the last 8 years in every single decision that you have proposed to us. But this, you went too far. And it was a 4-3 split decision in our board at that time for changing it. You ask them today, this is what they feel most proud. Changing the compensation of your executives. It makes a big difference. And reporting back our results to society. So we've been working ever since. We use GRI, Global Reporting Initiative, as a way in which we report back to society our commitments. So we report at the same time our economic, we report at the same time our social and environmental commitments. And this year, we were the first company to report in the standards GRI, which is the most comprehensive because of the materiality that we report with the new methodology. And we're working with them to continue improving the way we need to report our social and environmental KPIs, as well as, of course, our economic ones. But we like to everything that we committed or everything that we put forward is reviewed with the higher standards of this. So in summary, the way we do business, we measure our success in those three dimensions. We link our 3PL strategy with our compensation to our employees. We have a corporate purpose. And I hope each of your companies also has one. We base our competitive advantage in our people and our leadership model, and we invest more than 8% in terms of social investments. But going forward, so this is 2017 now, so we're always looking for the state-of-the-art sustainability practices. And we're willing to even experiment and create new paths. So for the last 18 months, I've been working under my new leadership model, all these collaborative teams I was sharing with you. And I think we have produced the most amazing strategy for FIFCO 2020 that I've ever imagined we could do. And that's all because of the hard work of these people. So I want to share some of these elements. I'm sorry, it's a small letters here, but sorry. The economic, so we have the three dimensions, right? So we said in the economic, we're going to double the size of our business by 2020, both top line and bottom line. You know, that's a tough one. But what I really want to share with you is my social and environmental commitments for FIFCO 2020. We came up with this very simple concept on the environmental that we call We Positive. We will become a water, emissions, and waste positive company. So what does it mean? Is that we're going to give back to society more than what we take from it in terms of the natural resources. Before, it were internal processes. Now our brands will be water positive, carbon positive, emissions positive. Imperial, which is our main brand in Costa Rica, 2 weeks ago, it declared itself the first water positive brand in the entire world, bringing more water. Thank you. But the difference, and I don't know many of you know about the circular economy. So before we were focused on our own internal processes, but now with the brands, what we're doing is what we call cradle to cradle. We are incorporating the footprints that our suppliers, you know, we buy raw materials, of course, you know, the mold, the cans, the packaging materials. So we are incorporating in our footprint all the footprint from our suppliers. Just to give you an idea for Imperial to be water positive, what it means. So 20% of the entire footprint, it was internal driven. 80% is related to the suppliers. So you can imagine then the amount of work that we had to do in order to become water positive for our brands. And that's a whole new standard. So we're working, influencing our value of chain now, in order to, for them to become much better. And we select now the suppliers based not on the price cost, you know, normal way of doing it, but the way you create to me your footprints. That's what really matters to me now. Of course, the economy always there. So that's on the environmental. And then on the social ones, we want to become, we call it six champions. We want to be the best company engaging in our communities. We want to be the employees working for the best company and also improving the way we consume our products, both alcohol and soft drinks, for instance. So 2 weeks ago, I came out publicly and I made 7 commitments to society. 2 weeks ago. Costa Rica in front of all the news guys, you know, all the reporters and everybody. And we said, this is what FIFCUS is standing for with these 7 commitments. We will complete 1 million hours of volunteer time off. But in order for us to reach 1 million hours, I cannot longer do with my employees only. I need now my consumers, I need my customers, my suppliers, even my shareholders, and they're gonna come and do BTO hours with us, hand in hand. We will be recognized as one of the top companies to work in the world. We'll become a reference in the smart consumption. We will eradicate poverty in all our companies. We will become a water waste and carbon positive company. We will reach out 100% recycling, which is a very sensitive topic. We recycle today 60% of the products that we put in the market, we recycle 60% back. So I have committed to recycle 100%, including the PET bottles, which is a big issue for us. And this new concept that I introduced to you, we will have the FIFCO Air Brands, we call it, lead through brands that make the world a better place. So our brands will become as light as the air in terms of their footprints, both social and environmental. So we have selected 7 of our top brands from our portfolio that does represent 60% of our volume and revenues, that they will become air brands by 2020. To wrap it up, I believe this new way of doing business allows us to connect in a whole different dimension with your stakeholders. I guarantee you, those who hate it, those that criticize you, when they see you taking ownership of the problems that you own create, you will find common ground. You can create private-public partnerships to solve many of these issues. My Minister of Health was the most anti-person against the industry. But when I sent the research to her on the consumption patterns, she said, Ramon, this is the best piece of information I ever seen in my entire career. And I said to the minister, yes, thank you. I want to continue increasing the per capita consumption of the beer in Costa Rica, I said to the minister, but I want to do it in a responsible manner. So she didn't say anything. We continued talking for half an hour. And at the end, she said, Ramon, if you would have not said that, I would ever believe you. She's my biggest supporter in a country that is very, very rigid in terms of laws. But we can change the way we connect with those people who oppose sometimes our businesses. We just have to create the consciousness within ourselves. And I believe this way of doing business improves the business climate and gives us a license to operate. Every single business, we all create footprints. Be aware of that. It's better to share the value, the wealth that we create, and also, believe me, it correlates with strong financial performance. I don't know what would happen to us if our performance would go down, but so far, you know, we had enjoyed year after year of increased profit pools for our shareholders. So they're very happy, but more importantly, they're very proud to be shareholders of our company. So the challenge ahead for me is, how do we convince business leaders, or even more important, the owners of capital, including their board of directors, that there is a better way of doing business by reconciling performance and progress? And why not a school like Babson, where I did my undergrad, that can be a frontier in changing the way we taught our students? I want my son, who is right now studying at Babson, that he can incorporate some of these principles when he graduates, because I know by doing that, we'll have a much better society, one that we'll feel most proud. Thank you very much. Thank you.